Now we are ready to develop our structure from motion algorithm. And this algorithm was proposed by Tomasi and Kanade and is referred to as the Tomasi-Kanade Factorization method. This algorithm is based on the properties of the observation matrix W, in particular, the rank of the observation matrix. We have discussed this before, but let's very quickly summarize it here. We know that W is the product of the motion matrix M, which is a 2F by 3 matrix, and the structure matrix S, which is a 3 by N matrix. So we know from the properties of ranks of matrices that the rank of W must be less or equal to the minimum of 3, N, and 2F, which are the dimensions of M and S right here. 3, N, and 2F. And we know that in our case, we have lots of scene points that we are interested in. N is a large number. We also have plenty of frames in our video at our disposal. F is a large number. Therefore, we can safely say that the rank of the observation matrix W must be less or equal to 3. This is referred to as the rank theorem or the rank constraint. And it is this constraint that makes it feasible for us to factorize the observation matrix W into its two components, M and S. Once we've done that, we know we've solved the structure from motion problem. So in order to do this factorization, we are going to use a very popular technique in linear algebra called singular value decomposition, SVD. And by the way, the SVD can be applied to any matrix, doesn't have to be our observation matrix here. Any matrix, let's say in matrix A, which is an M by N matrix, when you apply singular value decomposition, you're going to get three matrices. It's going to be the product of three matrices, U, sigma, and V transpose. And U and V here are orthonormal matrices. We have learned about orthonormal matrices before, and so U and V are orthonormal matrices. And of particular importance to us is this matrix in the center here, which is sigma, and that is a diagonal matrix. So if you wanted to compute this, there are standard methods for doing it. For instance, in MATLAB, you would just say SVD of A, and you would get the outputs U, S, and V, where S here corresponds to the sigma matrix right here. That simple. This is for any matrix. So now, let's take a look at the matrix sigma. This is of particular interest to us. It is a diagonal matrix, as we just mentioned, and along the diagonal, you have all your singular values, all your sigma values. These are the sigmas right here. And they're in descending order of importance. That is, sigma 1 is the most important singular value. These are all non-negative values, and sigma 1 will be the largest of them. Sigma 2 will be the next largest value, and so on and so forth. So what does that really mean? If you look at sigma 1 here, and if you did this, if you multiplied all of this out, sigma 1 would end up multiplying some of the rows and columns of U, the matrix U, and the matrix V. Well, those rows and columns make the largest contributions to the reconstruction of this matrix A. So those are the most important rows and columns of U and V. That's one way to think about it. And sigma 2 is the next most important singular value, and therefore the rows and columns that go with that one will be the second most important set of rows and columns of U and V, and so on and so forth. And by the way, I should mention that the columns of U are often referred to as the left singular vectors of the matrix A, and the rows of the matrix V are often referred to as the right singular vectors of the matrix A. So that's singular value decomposition. And now comes the important part, which is that if the rank of A, this matrix A, happens to be R, then that means there are only R non-zero singular values in this matrix right here, in sigma. Right? So now we can come back to our observation matrix and the rank constraint that we have derived. So we know that W, we can take our observation matrix, and let's just apply singular value decomposition to it, you're going to get the same, you're going to get these three matrices, U, sigma, and V right here. And now, if you look at these three matrices, you have U, which is a 2F by 2F matrix, you have V transpose, which is an N by N matrix, and right in the center here are your singular values. So that is sigma, which is a 2F by N matrix. You have all your sigmas here along the diagonal. So the sigmas, as we mentioned earlier, are in descending order of value, of importance. And the key observation in our context is we know that the rank of W must be less or equal to 3. And therefore, it can have at most 3 non-zero singular values, which means all the other sigmas in the matrix sigma here are going to be 0. So this is very powerful. These are massive matrices, but with very low rank. W has very low rank, as a result of which, very small number, 3 or less of the singular values here are going to be non-zero. The rest of the matrix is 0. So this has huge implications for us, because all except the first three diagonal elements of sigma must be equal to 0. And what that really means is that if you think about what are the chunks of these different matrices that have any bearing on the matrix W, you see that since only this 3x3 matrix in sigma has non-zero values, therefore, this submatrix of the matrix U, which we'll call U2, this has makes absolutely no contribution to W whatsoever. And the same applies to this submatrix of the matrix V, V transpose, that we'll call that V2 transpose. This has makes no contribution to the observation matrix W. And the reason is all the values in U2 and V2 transpose are going to be multiplied by zeros because we have singular values all equal to 0 down here. It is only the rows and columns of this submatrix U1 and this submatrix V1 transpose that end up contributing to W. Therefore, what we observe here is, despite the fact that the observation matrix is massive, and after applying singular value decomposition, you get these really large matrices, U, sigma, and V, the very small parts of these matrices that actually have any bearing on W, and the rest can essentially be ignored. So often, singular value decomposition is used to come up with a more economical representation of a matrix. So in our case, this is the economical representation right here. That is, W is, it's not an approximation, it's exactly equal to, because of the rank constraint, because all these values are 0, it's equal to U1, this submatrix, times sigma 1, which is this 3x3 matrix, times V1 transpose. So this is 2F by 3, this is 3x3, this is 3 by P. Okay, so now let's talk about factorization. So how do we now factorize W? Well, we have done the decomposition into U1, sigma 1, and V1. So you can perhaps factorize W by simply taking sigma 1 square root of sigma 1, and you multiply that with itself. That's one way of splitting up sigma 1 into two equal pieces. And so that then gives you this decomposition right here. It's a factorization. It's a completely valid factorization. This is a 2F by 3 matrix, a 3 by N matrix. And so this can, one could say that perhaps this could be your motion matrix. And perhaps this could be your structure matrix. But there's no reason to believe that that's the case, because we just came up with an equal split here. There's no reason that that equal split should lead to a valid motion matrix and a valid structure matrix. And that can be shown as follows. Let's say that you essentially post-multiply the first factor right here with a 3x3 matrix Q, any 3x3 matrix Q, and you pre-multiply the second factor here with the inverse of Q. Well, obviously, Q is going to have no impact in that case on W, but it's going to change both the factors, and those two are also two valid factors of W. And so one way to actually pose the question of what is M and what is S is by saying, what is the 3x3 matrix Q that we can use in here, which would end up in a valid M and motion matrix and a valid scene matrix? So how do we compute Q? That's how we're going to now pose the rest of the structure for motion problem. So the question really is, how do we find the matrix Q? Well, from this expression right here, there's no really obvious way to move forward, but turns out that there are constraints that we haven't yet used. So that brings us to the orthonormality of M. So let's look at the motion matrix M once again. What is M? It's simply a stacking of all of these I's and J's, the I's for all the F frames and the J's for all the F frames. These again are unit vectors, and each IJ pair defines the orientation of the camera for that frame. So that's what the motion matrix is. Now, this motion matrix is this factor that we have computed, U1 times sigma 1, a square root of that, this factor which we've already computed, times some unknown 3x3 matrix Q. This is what we're looking for. Once again, if you're able to find this matrix, 3x3 matrix Q, then we've essentially solved the problem, because then we have found both the motion and the structure of the scene. So that's true. And so now this part that we have computed can be rewritten as another set of vectors here, perhaps not unit vectors, but vectors I through I1 through IF and J1 through JF times Q. And now you can take the Q in to rewrite this in this form. So once again, we do not know Q. What we have computed are all the I hats and J hats. All right, now we come back to these I's and J's right here. Well, these have a certain constraints that they must satisfy, which is that each one of them is a unit vector, which is IF dot IF should be equal to 1, JF times JF should be equal to 1. And the I's and J's are orthogonal to each other, because they define your coordinate frame. So IF dot JF should be equal to 0. So these are three constraints we have not used thus far. Those are the orthonormality constraints. And so for IF and JF, if we plug in the expressions right here, you get these three equations. These three constraints end up mapping to these three expressions, where the I hats and J hats are known, they're computed. The matrix Q is the only unknown right here. So you see here that for one frame, any one frame, we get these three equations right here. But we have F frames. So we have these three expressions for each frame. So in total, we have three F equations. And Q is a 3x3 matrix, and therefore it has 9 unknowns or variables. And so we can use, as long as we have 3 or more frames, which we almost always do, 3 or more frames, that is, if F is greater or equal to 3, then we have enough equations to solve for the 9 unknowns in Q using, for instance, the Newton's method. So once we've found Q, then we simply plug that back into the expressions for the camera motion matrix M and the scene structure matrix S, and our structure from motion problem has been solved. So let's summarize structure from motion using the Tomasi-Kanade factorization method. What we do is we capture a video of a scene, and you basically want to ensure that in each frame you're essentially looking at the same scene. You detect and track feature points, And then you take the coordinates of these feature points and you centroid subtract them. And so then you use those coordinates to construct your observation matrix W. Once you've computed your observation matrix, you're going to apply singular value decomposition to that observation matrix, and you're going to enforce your rank constraint so you get this economical representation of W, that is U1 times sigma 1 times V1 transpose. Once you've done that, you're going to split the sigma into two equal pieces, but you're going to insert a Q in there. So you're going to essentially define M as U1 sigma 1 square root times Q, and S as Q inverse sigma 1 square root times V1T. So the only unknowns here are the elements of Q. And we are going to solve for Q by using the orthonormality constraint. And once we have solved for Q, we can plug that back in here and we have M and S. So now let's take a look at some early examples. This was developed by Tomasi almost 30 years ago. And so these are some of his first results which he shared with me. So here is a sequence of images and features are tracked. And from this set of features, again, using the orthographic assumption, you're able to construct the 3D locations of points. So this is a view that is a rendered view of the scene shown as a different 3D perspective of the 3D house. And you can see that the reconstruction looks fairly realistic. Here's another example where a sequence of images were taken of this outdoor scene. These are the features that were tracked. And from that, one is able to reconstruct this sort of reconstruction of the scene. These are two different perspectives of the same scene. Now, I should mention that these are very early results. These are essentially the first results on structure from motion using the factorization method. But since then, many of the assumptions that were made in the early algorithm have been relaxed. For instance, it's been extended to perspective cameras, to cameras that have changing focal length, that is zooming effects, and then also the processing of all of these features that are being detected, that's become more sophisticated because in this algorithm, we are actually assuming that each feature is seen through the entire video sequence. But as you know, as you're capturing the video of a scene, features are going to come in, disappear, sometimes reappear, and so on and so forth. So there are more and more sophisticated techniques that have been developed, but the core ideas began to emerge from this algorithm developed by Tomasi-Kanade. So one of the more recent implementations by Marc Polyphase is this one right here. I'll just show you one result. This is the video that I showed you at the beginning of the lecture. And so this is a captured video. Uncontrolled, casual, handheld video. And from this video, the features have been tracked and an observation matrix created. And then the algorithm is applied and you get a point cloud. So what you're seeing in the center here is the 3D coordinates of the points in the scene. And these little cones that you're looking at are the locations of the camera that were computed from the camera motion matrix. So both structure and motion have been computed. And once you have this point cloud, of course, the point cloud is very sparse, but you can interpolate the point cloud to get a continuous depth map that looks something like this. It's being rendered using some chosen lighting and material property. But in fact, you also have the brightness and color at each point in the image, and therefore you can texture map this depth map to get something that looks like this, much more realistic, actually looks like the original video. But now, since you have 3D structure, you can look at it from any perspective you want.